Good morning, Your Honors. Kathy Carter for the appellant. Your Honors, consistent with the TILA, the circuit courts throughout the country that have confronted the issue of consumer debt under the FDCPA have recognized the reach of the FDCPA is limited to consensual transactions in which the right to acquire money, property, insurance, or services, primarily for household purposes, is extended to a consumer for a deferred payment. This definition of debt or consumer debt under the FDCPA has been recognized in the Third Circuit, the Ninth Circuit, the Eleventh Circuit, and the Seventh Circuit. In so doing, the Third Circuit, in the Zimmerman case, actually found that the type of transaction, which is the key word in the definition of debt under the FDCPA, the type of transaction which may give rise to a debt as defined by the FDCPA is the same type of transaction that is dealt with in all other subchapters of the Consumer Credit Protection Act, which, as we know, includes the TILA. And these are one involving the offer of extension of credit to a consumer. Specifically, it is a transaction where a consumer is extended credit, giving them the right to acquire money, property, insurance, or services which are primarily for household purposes.
Your argument is this was a business credit card?
Yes, Your Honor.
It was used to buy consumer goods?
That was testimony that the debtor provided during trial.
So
yes.
What difference does your argument make?
Because when the circuit courts look at the definition of debt, and specifically the word transaction and how that is used, they're looking at the consensual transaction, which would be the transaction between
the two. And you don't look at what they used it for, is that your argument?
That is correct.
That forecloses anything after that fact.
It eliminates.
It does not qualify for the Consumer Debt Protection Act.
It does not qualify for protection.
And your number one case on that is what?
Zimmerman.
So it's like what we said, it doesn't even matter if the borrower deceives the lender and tells the lender it's being used for business purposes and does all sorts of things to make it look like it was a business loan. If the borrower's purpose in obtaining the loan was consumer, that's all that matters. So as long as the borrower has secretly in his heart that he's going to use the funds or the loan for consumer purposes, it doesn't matter what he tells the lender. Isn't that what we said in Slink?
No, Your Honor, actually, I don't think that is what this court said in Slink. I mean, those words are in the opinion, but I think that the distinction.
Those words are in the opinion, that's what we said in Slink.
No, because.
That may not be it's an interesting interpretation of the statute, but that is the interpretation we're living with now.
Well, in Slink, the court actually looked at the transaction itself, which was the loan made.
To a business, right?
And the loan documents.
He's a contractor. He lied to the IRS, too, I believe, in saying that it was a business and got some advantages, but it was actually only for his own house. I mean, that was the thing that case turned on, I think. It was actually only for his own house.
Well, in Slank, the court looked at the loan documents where the loan was made for the purpose of purchasing the backhoe and other household goods or personal goods, was the language in the document. That is the consensual transaction that was entered into that has to be looked at under the definition of debt. That transaction in and of itself, the extension of credit made by the lender, and the acceptance of that credit by the borrower did not identify that backhoe had to be for a consumer purpose or that it had to be for a business purpose. The lender didn't say, I am only extending you this credit for the purpose of consumer, personal, household, or family. It wasn't contained within that transaction expressly, like it is in the extension of credit under a business credit card. So what the court did, the court looked at that, and the dispute between the parties was the backhoe, because it was undisputed that the money was spent 100% on the backhoe, despite that language in the contract. And the parties then argued, well, but the backhoe was being used only for the home and therefore was household purpose. And no, the backhoe, the tax returns took a tax deduction. It was reported to the IRS that it was a business purchase and therefore it was business. So I think what the court in Slank did is it took the transaction, which is what the FDCPA and even TILA require. It examined the transaction for the purpose of that extension of credit and the acceptance of that credit. It did not answer the question. Did that creditor say, I'm extending you this credit and it is only for a consumer purpose or only for a business purpose or I don't care what the purpose is? So the court then said, we have to look to the borrower's purpose or the use that was made of that backhoe in order to determine what that original consensual transaction required or purpose was for in order to determine if it's a consumer debt under the FDCPA. And what the court determined was that there was evidence that existed that it was a consumer purchase or that it was a business purpose. But then we get into the primarily language.
Blank says the lender's motives don't matter. And the fashion in which the loan has been memorialized is not dispositive. Instead, we look to the substance of the transaction and the borrower's purpose in obtaining the loan.
Correct.
And as long as Link purchased the backhoe primarily for consumer purposes, that was what was controlled our analysis. So if the lender's motives don't matter, what does it matter if the lender says, oh, I'm just giving you this for business use?
Because the definition of transaction looks to the consensual transaction, as the consensus of the courts across the country has been, looks to the original transaction and that purpose, and the lender didn't have a purpose within that original transaction. So what would the court be left to consider?
I mean, that sort of stops me. The lender's motives don't matter. What we said.
Yes, I recognize that, and I think that that is the language that has been, and only that language out of Slink that has been relied on across the country in concluding that we can ignore, even though it is a consensual transaction, which is required, and this court said that as well. Then the courts say, but we get to ignore what the lender, what their part of that consensual transaction was, and we'll look only to the borrower, and we'll look down the road, which could be years. Could even be decades.
Are you the Ms. Carter who tried this case?
I am, Your Honor.
I'm kind of curious about one thing. When it comes down to this voicemail, the court says, I understand it, perhaps I don't understand it. There's no doubt that your employee, I guess that's Greg Dalton, called Mr. Davis and failed to communicate at that time who he was, whatever Mr. Davis knew. Is that correct, Ms. Carter? No, Your Honor, I don't believe that to be accurate. The court, okay. Ms. Carter, there's a voicemail, and I guess that's the center of this whole case. There's a voicemail which the plaintiff will testify is from my office. I cannot confirm that. I do not recognize that voice to be the person who they're claiming it to be. That's supposedly Greg Dalton, right?
Yes, sir.
Did you ask Greg Dalton whether that was his voice on the email?
I asked Greg Dalton if he had left voicemail messages, but I still cannot confirm, and he could not. Well, by the time I had the actual audio, Mr. Dalton didn't work for me anymore, so I never played that for him and asked him if it was him. I did not.
That's pretty silly. He was working for you at the time, right?
Yes, he was.
Are you disclaiming that was Greg Dalton?
No, I'm saying I can't. I am not able to confirm that that's Mr. Dalton's voice on that message. I'm not disclaiming that it is his voice, and I did not do that in trial.
I mean, it's silly. It's just silly.
Yes.
So the district court didn't make a finding as to when the voicemail message was made. Is that right?
I believe that is correct, yes.
So we don't know when it was made was there evidence at trial about assuming the voicemail message is from Dalton and he does identify himself as Gregory?
Correct.
Assuming it's from him. Was there any evidence about when, amidst the conversations that Davis was having with Hollins Law and Mr. Dalton, that it was made?
Yeah, there is evidence of the exchanges that were occurring, email, telephone calls, and voicemail between the two of them. Yes.
And so at what point was this message made?
When in the sequence of all these communications?
I don't know.
Does the record know?
Let's see.
I mean, was this the first communication, the middle communication, the last communication, or when in the sequence was it?
According to the evidence that was submitted, which were the notes from our collection software, this would have been in the middle. And I'm guessing that this recording went with a voicemail that Mr. Dalton noted that he had left.
And in Mr. Davis' deposition, does that say that he recognized who this was and understood what the call was all about?
Yes, he does.
So he has requests for admissions where he says, upon hearing the voice message, plaintiff understood that it was from a debt collector by combining the message itself with plaintiff's prior knowledge that defendant was a debt collector. So he's admitting in there that he knew it was, that defendant was a debt collector.
Yes, Your Honor.
But not from the voicemail message alone. He says from combining it with his prior knowledge.
Right, the voicemail message itself does not contain the words debt collector.
What happened to the attorney's fees dispute?
Attorney's fees were awarded to Mr. Davis.
Is that in the record someplace? I know Judge, I read the trial and it's all about attorney's fees at the end.
Correct.
Judge Carlton says this is de minimis, it's all about attorney's fees, and then he just sort of trails out. Where in the record does it say what the attorney's fees award was?
I don't think that's in the record, Your Honor, the attorney's fees award.
Well, that, I couldn't find it, so I guess maybe it's not. What was it?
It was approximately $40,000.
That's what this case was all about, attorney's fees.
Yes.
Do you want to save the rest of your time for rebuttal?
Yes, please. Thank you.
Good morning. I don't think the case was all about attorney's fees. I think that it is.
It's a $1,000 case at most, correct?
That's right.
And the attorney's fees run up were $40,000?
That's what I believe, yes.
Your client knew who this person was who was calling, what it was all about, that it was a debt collector. It seems to me your position is completely form over substance.
I think that it is dangerous to advocate for what would be a judicial repeal of a protection specifically put in place by Congress simply because a given set of facts isn't particularly egregious. And the facts here are
not egregious at all.
Well, they're not egregious at all, but the facts are the facts, and they constitute a violation of
over substance.
Well, let's look at the statute. So the statute says that the failure to disclose in subsequent communications that the communication is from a debt collector. And the district court, in the district court cases, seem to substitute the word state for disclose, like the failure to state in subsequent communications that the communication is from a debt collector. But Congress chose to use the word disclose, which just means to make known. So why wasn't the fact that the caller, Mr. Dalton, said, you know, this is Gregory and I'm calling you, call me back, why doesn't his disclosing his name disclosed to Mr. Davis that it was a debt collector? Because as he says, as he admits, he understood it was a debt collector by combining the message itself, identifying the caller as Gregory, with plaintiff's prior knowledge that Mr. Dalton was representing a debt collector. Why doesn't that do actually closer to the statutory language than substituting the word state, which I think is what you're trying to interpret it as?
If I understand you correctly, the statute says that the specific disclosure, the lesser disclosure in connection with a subsequent communication, has to be that this is a debt collector.
It has has to disclose that the subsequent communication is from a debt collector.
Right.
And so the question is, the district court seemed to think that that meant to state, so that any call would have to say, this is from Greg Dalton, a debt collector. But the statute doesn't require the statement. It just requires disclose as from a debt collector, which he did by identifying himself as Gregory, the person that Mr. Davis knew. Mr. Davis knew very well who he was.
I understand what you're saying. And I respectfully disagree that the disclosure was made, and this is why. If you look to the admission that Your Honor's pointed to, Mr. Davis denied that he knew the debt collector, or that the caller was a debt collector. What he said was, by thinking back, by thinking about the context of the circumstances, it dawned on me, I put two and two together and said that I realized a previous communication was made, and now I know that this is who's calling. Yes. That's important.
So if I call my clerk and say, this is Sandra Ikuda, can you get me that bench memo?
Right.
I don't have to say, this is Sandra Ikuda, a federal judge, can you get me a bench memo? Because the law clerk knows very well who I am. And so Mr. Dalton, who I guess had a course of discussions with Mr. Davis before this voicemail message, was aware that Mr. Davis knew very well who Gregory was. And in fact, that's what he admits, that he knew very well who he was, based on the message and his knowledge. I mean, that's always how we understand who somebody is calling.
For the most part. But Mr. Davis isn't a federal judge, and the statute requires that we look at this against the backdrop of the least sophisticated consumer, which is a hypothetical.
But that's not objective. So wouldn't even somebody who had had a series of calls with a person knowing that he was an employee of Hollins Law collecting a debt, I think even the least sophisticated debtor would understand that the fifth call from the same person after a series of discussions to try to resolve a debt was the same guy you'd been talking to before. I don't see how this objective standard makes any difference in this analysis.
I understand your position. I think and I know that there are district courts that disagree. Obviously, they're district courts, but this is what they say, that there is no burden upon a consumer to remember who called him or her in the past, that some of the consumers in the position of Mr. Davis owe many debts. They owe debts from who knows what it is, and that they don't have a burden to remember who called them and to put together what Mr. Davis did in the sense of 2 plus 2 equals 4, and I recall from something else that this is the case. So if you look at the least sophisticated consumer, which is really the bottom rung of the sophistication ladder, the point is to protect not only...
Well, I don't know, because in Turkemeyer, how do you pronounce that? That case, that set the least sophisticated debtor standard, Turgeman. We also said, yeah, we're not going to be hyper-technical, even though they mislabeled a portion of the debt as interest. We're not going to, it was literally false, but we're not going to be hyper-technical here. There was enough for the least sophisticated debtor. I mean, even more so, it seems, if you're having a course of communications with someone over a brief period of time, this was within a month, not like over years later, it was within a month. I think, unless somebody has some mental disability, you know that it's the same person calling you. So aren't you being very hyper-technical that, or the court was saying, you have to state this is Gregory, a debt collector, or otherwise you run afoul of the statute. I mean, I don't think our cases stand for that.
I think they do. I think that the point you make that this is a wonder a day apart isn't relevant when we look at the standard that we have to use. I think that...
You don't look at the context. I mean, obviously we look at the context of the... in order to understand whether the least sophisticated debtor would understand this.
Sure.
I mean, that's what they did in Turkoman. They said, we can't expect him to know that this was the same lender because it was years later, whatever. So they looked at the context. Here we got a month. It was communications within a month.
So from this court, its opinion in Clark, the least sophisticated consumer standard protects the goldos wealth of the shrewd, the ignorant, the unthinking, and the credulous. So I think that...
Right, but not the... Here, it's just a matter of knowing who Gregory was, which he obviously didn't admit as much.
I think But you're right. I also believe that the subjective interpretation of Mr. Davis is irrelevant. I think
it is. It is, but at least it's another data point showing that a person who's had a series of calls with someone over a month knows who he is when he calls back and says, this is Gregory, can you call me back? It's important.
Sure. So then we look at this, and I think the Second Circuit made it its first point. There are many ways to justify why Congress did what it did in requiring the lesser disclosure that it required as of the 1996 amendment. But the Second Circuit said this: even if there were little discernible purpose in repetition, Congress is free to exercise its legislative judgment to adopt a reasonable margin of safety to ensure its remedial goal. And we are not at liberty to substitute a view different from that expressed by Congress in a legislative enactment.
So, you like the Clark case. What do you do with the language that says, moreover, we're not bound by the plain meaning of a statute where its literal application will produce a result demonstrably at odds with the intention of its drafters? On and on and on. We're not required to interpret a statute in a formalistic manner when such an interpretation would produce a result contrary to the statute's purpose or lead to an unreasonable result. It seems like they're talking about this case.
I don't think that it's an unreasonable result.
Where in the record is the deposition of your client talking about what he understood when he received that voicemail?
Where in the deposition? I don't know.
Where in the record is
it? I don't know. I know that the request for admission that...
Is this in the excerpt of record, the discussion, the deposition?
I believe that it is.
Where?
I can't tell you the record excerpt number, Your Honor.
I have ER 199.
I believe it's... Is there a question, Your Honor?
So you told us earlier that when he got the voicemail, he didn't know who it was from.
This is response to request for admission number 14.
Request for admission.
Right.
It's a deposition. It's a deposition quoted in here.
This is all I have.
I think what we were discussing and what opposing counsel was discussing was
I heard you say that your client, when he heard this voicemail, didn't know who it was from. But then when he thought, later on, he went, oh, wait a minute, that must have been from Hollins.
Right, that's the request for admission that I'm referring to.
Well, that says, upon hearing the voicemail, upon hearing the voice message, plaintiff understood it was from a debt collector.
Upon hearing, that's what I'm getting at. You told us that it was, oh, later on, he said, oh, wait a second. And I want to know, where is that in the record?
I don't know.
It's not there. That didn't happen. You misrepresented the record.
And I apologize. What I was referring to, and I said, was the request for admission. And the request for admission obviously says what it says. And my characterization.
You can't take liberties with a record like this.
I understand.
You know, I might not get it, but I have these beady-eyed clerks that are going to find it, and then you're going to be in trouble.
Right.
He understood at the moment that he heard it who it was from and what the purpose of it was.
Right.
Right. Okay.
With respect to the request for admission, that's right. And we have a Congress that specifically took a look at this court's decision in Presley, right? We go back to 1985. We say that this court took a look at a pre-amendment version of the FDCPA and said that a full disclosure is required with respect to the initial communication, and it isn't required with respect to the subsequent communication.
I'm sure in law school they give us a Latin phrase. It was called cessante ratione legis, cessante ipsa lex. And that means exactly what Clark says. If the application of the statute produces a ridiculous result, you don't do it.
I don't think that it produces...
This is a ridiculous result. It has nothing to do with... Where is the abusive behavior on the part of the debt collector in this case?
There isn't.
There isn't.
Behavior. And the point is, it's not particularly egregious. And there are safeguards written into the FDCPA to deal with a situation like this.
And you saw fit to go after attorney's fees of $40,000 in a situation where there was zero damage to your client. You filed a preemptive lawsuit in order to prohibit anybody from trying to collect the debt. This seems to me to be an abusive process.
I don't think that it's an abusive process.
I know you don't.
Someone that Congress put into place, and if we read the statute as Your Honor suggests, we read out of existence these protections specifically afforded. Now, we take a look at the Presley case, right? We go back. So in response to this court's decision that some sort of communication didn't require exactly what, you know, we're talking about, we had the 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 6th, and 7th circuits that rejected interpretation. So what happened in 1996, Congress specifically rewrote Section 6092E11 of the FDCPA to do two things. One, to differentiate between initial communication and subsequent communication, and to actually require that every subsequent communication include a disclosure that we are talking about today. And the point being that...
Mr. Singh doesn't specify the text of the disclosure.
The text, it says that the debt collector has to notify the consumer that it is a debt collector. Disclose. Yes.
Yes, but neither, but we haven't indicated that there are any specific words that need to be spoken. So it doesn't say the failure to state that the communications from a debt collector. It just says to have to make that disclose. There's no magic language that provided in the statute.
This functionally discloses that. And your client knew that the minute he heard it. Isn't that the proof of the pudding is always in the eating? Isn't that the eating? He knew it. He understood it as a disclosure on the spot. Not later on when a light bulb went off, as you told us earlier.
The request for permission says what it says. It says that he understood it was a debt collector by combining the message itself with plaintiff's prior knowledge that the defendant was a debt collector. And the point being that the least sophisticated consumer, he simply wouldn't combine that knowledge. The person on the bottom rung of the
consumer wouldn't.
No, what if you were thinking the credulous?
You're describing a least sophisticated consumer as somebody with an IQ under room temperature.
I mean, you can't really say that somebody doesn't know when he's gotten repeated calls from someone and the person calls back and says, this is Gregory, please call me back, that the least sophisticated debtor won't know who Gregory is. Is that what you're saying?
No, not in this particular, not with respect to Mr. Davis. I don't. With respect to consumers not in Mr. Davis's position.
I mean, in the context.
They were back to Clark that says you don't do this.
I don't understand. Don't do this.
Yeah, you don't use a statute to accomplish a ridiculous result that's completely at counter purposes with what the statute is supposed to
accomplish. But Congress decided that this was the best way to effectuate the remedial purpose of the FDCPA.
Congress did. Yeah, okay.
I think that's true. I think that Congress decided this was the best way to do it. And the leeway that Congress has afforded in carrying out its remedial scheme is something that we owe some deference to. I understand Your Honor's position. I really do. I understand that this isn't an egregious set of facts. I understand that this isn't appealing. But I think that it's dangerous to take away a congressionally afforded protection simply because a given set of facts isn't something that everybody says, wow, that's a terrible thing. It wasn't a terrible thing. Now, take a look at the damage component. There's no need to award the maximum damage award. There's a safeguard built into the FDCPA. It says the judge could award $1 on damages if he wanted to, given a set of circumstances like this. And the judge actually looked at the facts and said, this isn't egregious, so I'm not going to award the maximum damage relief available. That's built into the FDCPA. It worked as it should. It did what it was supposed to do. Now, the fact, again, that the circumstances aren't overly appealing, they're not, doesn't mean that we should write out of existence the plain language of the statute as it is written because a particular set of facts isn't overwhelmingly appealing. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honors. All that I would really add at this time on the issue of the communications between Mr. Davis and Mr. Dalton is that the voicemail message that was documented in the record for September 25th, which we're assuming would coincide with the recording that we heard, and that's in the record, was actually a response to a request from Mr. Davis where he had reached out to Mr. Dalton via an email and said they were in settlement discussions trying to resolve Mr. Davis's debt. And he reached out and said, can you get me a status on my offer? Because he had an offer pending to resolve the debt. Mr. Davis had indicated by email that he didn't have a response yet. He wasn't sure when he would get one. And the phone call immediately followed that same day, or the voicemail message followed that day, and then immediately followed by a phone call where Mr. Davis...
And where in the record is this that you're giving this to me?
This is in volume 2... at 106.
106?
Yes, 106 through 109, which 109 illustrates the date. That the only actually confirmed instance of a voicemail message being left that we had.
Can you say the sequence again?
Yes. So the bulk of the conversation right before the email took place in a 15-day period, September 10th through September 25th, okay. Immediately preceding the voicemail at issue.
Meaning the same day? The same day as the voicemail was left, or the day before, 2 weeks before? What? Just give the sequence again.
Okay. So I'll start with... September 11th of 2012, Mr. Dalton emailed Mr. Davis requesting that Mr. Davis provide a dollar amount for the offer because he had offered a percentage, which was 30% of the debt. Same day, Mr. Davis emails Mr. Dalton and asks for the amount that he owes to American Express.
That's 2:12 p.m.
Yes. And then... Mr. Dalton emails Mr. Davis and provides him a report, an accounting of the debt that he owes to American Express. 6 days later, Mr. Davis emails Mr. Dalton and asks if he can get a status on his pending offer.
So all of the communications from Davis to Dalton appear to be redacted, at least in the version I have. Is that correct?
No, the emails and the communications between Davis and Dalton are in there. The redactions are communicated.
The other stuff, other people.
That's our clients, our communications with our clients.
Got it.
So we're on the 12th.
So we're on the 17th. So we went from the 11th
to
the 17th.
Okay.
And then Mr. Dalton on the 17th again emails Mr. Davis back and advises he doesn't have an update from the client yet and that he doesn't know how long it's going to take him to hear back. On the 25th of September... So 8 days later, Mr. Dalton leaves the allegedly offending voicemail.
Wait, I thought that voicemail was left in response to a call that Mr. Davis had placed. That
response to Mr. Davis's email requesting the status of the offer.
6 days earlier.
Yes.
That's the most prior to the voicemail, the immediately preceding conversation or communication between them is 6 days.
Yes. And then... the voicemail is left, and you've heard the content of that voicemail. And then if you look at...
Well, does it really matter what happens after, does it?
No, except that you can see that the next conversation is Mr. Dalton trying to tell him that the offer had been rejected.
Okay, well, so, yeah, I was just trying to, if we were going to write something that explained what the sequence was. So 6 days prior is the last communication, and then the voicemail gets left.
Correct. That's all that I had to add. Thank you very much, Your Honors.
Did you appeal the attorney's fees award?
No. I actually was trying to look that up because I had a feeling you were going to ask me that. I believe we appealed the judgment and asserted that if the judgment is reversed, so too has to be the attorney award, which is dependent upon the judgment.
You didn't assert that. You're saying that follows?
Yes. Yeah. I don't know the answer. I mean, I assume we did, but I actually didn't look specifically at that issue recently.
Are you seriously pushing the idea that the bona fide defense was still in the pretrial order?
I think it was inherently within there, but I understand that I certainly wish that we had made it clear.
All right. Thank you for your argument. The case of Davis v. Hollins Law is submitted. We have one additional case submitted on the briefs. It's Holmberg v. American Insurance Company.